morning. Good to see you guys this weekend. Hope you guys are doing well. We have an exciting announcement for you from the Stratton family. So here it is. We're expecting another baby. So now you know the good news. Woo-hoo! Exciting, right? Also, number two is we want you to be looking because we are going to announce our Summer Fun Days Family Edition coming up in August. We're gonna show, we're gonna post the registration soon, so be looking for that. It's gonna be so cool. There's gonna be a take-home package that's gonna help you get really into it and involved with it, so look out for it. But enjoy this morning. We're starting a new series called Ingredients to a Godly Life.
Going on, boys and girls, Stevie Sunshine here, and I'm going to teach you some new summer dance moves, so get up and get ready. Here we go, baby.
Hey everybody, I'm TV Chef Guy, and we're rolling out. We're traveling the pages of the Bible, looking for ingredients of a godly life. Our journey starts right here in the book of 2 Kings, at the home of a widow and her young son.
Oh, hello there, stranger.
Hello, widow woman.
The name is Madeline.
Say, Madeline, is that olive oil I keep hearing about that you make?
Well, it's not much.
Mmm. That's good oil. Fist bump. No? You don't do that?
I'm not sure.
Madeline, can you tell my friends here what the secret ingredient is in your oil?
It's just oil. There's no secret ingredient.
Is there trust in there, though?
Trust?
That's right. Madeline uses a big bowl of trust to make this oil.
I do?
Madeline was poor, and she was about to lose her sons because she could not pay her debts. But then a man of God named Elisha told her to trust him.
He told me to get as many jars as I could and start pouring oil into each one. I only had one small jar with a little oil in it. But when I trusted the man of God, I started to fill up every single jar. I filled enough jars to sell the oil and make the money to keep my sons.
And that's all because of what ingredient?
I guess you're right. It's trust.
A godly life starts with a big bowl of trust. Just take it from my friend, Madeline.
No, don't take it from me. Get your own.
Good idea. Get your own bowl and fill it with trust. You'll be on your way to a godly life. Thanks, Maddie.
Who was that guy?
Hey guys, how many of you start off your day with a piece of toast? No? How about a bowl of cereal? I know a lot of people who start their day off with a bowl of cereal. And I, for one, this is my favorite cereal to start the day off, Rice Krispies. But I don't just add Rice Krispies. Some of us eat cereal every day and it gets a little bit boring. But a fun tip for you is that with your cereal, you could add some fruit. I love Rice Krispies with banana, but you could have strawberries or blueberries or another berry or something like that and add it to your cereal, and it just makes it that more, much more delicious or that much more nutritious. So, add some milk. This is a fun little snack you guys can make, and this is literally my breakfast. I literally eat this every single morning. So just plop those bananas right on top. And not gonna lie, don't tell your parents, but I add a spoonful of sugar on top too. How many of you eat a sugary cereal to begin with? So this isn't a sugary cereal, but I do add a little bit of extra. I don't add like a whole spoonful, just like a little bit of sugar sprinkled on top to make it a little bit sweeter. But this is my desired breakfast. I love it. Breakfast is the most important meal of the day. And just like breakfast is the most important meal of the day, trust, a bowl of trust is what we're talking about today, is so important in knowing God. A godly life starts with a bowl full of trust. Just as breakfast is the most important meal of the day, trust is so important in knowing God and believing in the Bible. Trust will get each day started on the right foot. Enjoy.
Good morning, boys and girls. Leader Cheryl here to share today's Bible lesson. We are starting a new series, Ingredients of a Godly Life. But before we get to today's story, I have a question. How many of you have been cooking at home? For some, cooking can be seen as a chore, but many people actually really enjoy cooking. It can be a lot of fun. Some people even love to cook. Cooking at home can be a healthier option as well, and it's a great way for us to show love to our friends and family. When we make something special and share it with the people that we love, it makes us feel good, but it also makes them feel loved. The people that we share with can recognize the thought, time, and effort that went into creating that dish, and that can often make it tastier than any restaurant. How many of you can think of a recipe that one of your friends or family members makes the best? Like, my grandma makes the best butter tarts, or my dad makes the best ribs. I'm sure we can all think of one. And it's not necessarily that there's a special hidden ingredient, it's that it was made with love by a loved one. So love isn't something that you store in a spice rack. You can't scoop it up with a measuring cup, but it is definitely in every home-cooked meal. It's in every bowl, on every plate, in every bite. So over the next several weeks, we're gonna be looking at invisible ingredients that we all need in order to have a godly life, and how we can combine these ingredients in our hearts to make us disciples of Christ. We're gonna pull out a big bowl for today's first ingredient because it's an important one. If you look at most recipes, often the first ingredient is the item that you'll need the most of. And that's exactly the case for today. Our first ingredient is trust. And we need a big bowl of trust if we wanna live a godly life. God asks for a lot of trust from us. He asks us to trust that He is the one true God, that the Bible is our recipe book for life, and He often asks us to step out and show our trust. And as we'll see from today's scripture, when we do that, when we step out and show the world that we are going to trust in God, He will reward us with unexpected blessings. Okay, so today we are going to be reading from 2 Kings 4, 1-7. It's the story of the widow's oil. It says, "The wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elisha, 'Your servant, my husband, is dead, and you know that he revered the Lord. But now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves.' Elisha replied to her, 'How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your house?' 'Your servant has nothing there at all,' she said, 'except a small jar of olive oil.' Elisha said, 'Go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few. Then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons. Pour the oil into the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side. She left him and shut the door behind her and her sons. They brought the jars to her, and she kept pouring. When all the jars were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another one." But he replied, "There's not a jar left." Then the oil stopped flowing. She went and told the man of God, and he said, "Go, sell the oil, pay your debts. You and your sons can live on what is left." So at the start of this story, we feel really bad for this widow. She's got no money. She's in debt. She's lost her husband. He's passed away. And now she's at risk of losing her sons because she can't pay off her husband's debt. And nowadays, we have so much stuff that we could easily just sell it. A lot of people would have yard sales just for fun. And now we can do it all online. But she didn't have a lot of items to sell. So when she went to Elisha for help, he said, "What do you have?" And her first response was, "I have nothing." Because anything that she did possess within her house, which wasn't a lot, she needed. So the only thing she could think of was, "I have some oil, and I could sell oil," which was a good thing to sell at the time. The problem was she didn't have a lot. She said, "I have a little bit of oil." So not even a full jar to sell. Even one jar of oil was probably not going to be enough to pay off the debt. But Elisha said to her, "Okay, here's what you're going to do. You're going to go to your neighbors and you're going to gather up all the jars you can. You and your sons are going to get as many as you can. Don't get just a few, get all of them. And you're going to go back to your house, close the door, and you are going to pour out that oil. And God is going to use that little bit that you have to make a big difference." So in trust, that's exactly what she did. Her and her sons, they gathered the jars, they went home, and from this little bit of oil, she pours it into the first jar and it fills up. So they move it to the side. They get another empty jar, they pour it, the second one, it fills up. Same thing with the third, and they keep going and going and going until they ran out of jars. They ran out of jars before they ran out of oil. God provided so much that there was extra. Because from the story, we can see that Elisha says, "Okay, you can now sell that oil to save your sons, and you can live off of what is left." So God didn't just meet her needs, he exceeded her needs because she stepped out in trust. She had no reason to believe that what Elisha was saying would work. She knew how much oil was left in those jars. How was that little bit of oil supposed to fill all of these jars? It would take a miracle to save her sons. And God gave her that miracle because she trusted him. God wants us to trust him the same way so that we can live a godly life just like this woman did. Now, when I read this story aloud, a lot of you might be thinking of a story that comes later in the Bible, a story of a young boy who packed a lunch to go and listen to Jesus preach. In a crowd of 5,000 people, Jesus decided to feed all of these people. So this young boy offered up his lunch of 5 loaves and 2 fish. Now, the boy, like the woman, knew that what he had was not enough to meet the needs of all that were there. But he trusted Jesus, and Jesus performed a miracle. God wants us to put our trust in him. Just like the widow and the young boy, he gave us a book filled with stories like these so that we might believe that he is who he says he is and that we can place our trust in him. Boys and girls, God has a plan for our lives. First and foremost, he wants to save us from sin, and he wants to have a relationship with us through his son, Jesus Christ. God can use our bowls of trust to be a witness to the world so that when people look at us, they see people who believe. They'll see enough in the story of our lives to pour a bowl of trust for themselves. Then they too can discover a godly life. Without trust, we might never take the first steps to following God. We might not have the faith to open the Bible and see where God wants to lead us. Trust that God is God. Trust that Jesus is the Son of God. Trust the Bible to reveal God and God's plan. Trust God to lead you, and you will never go astray. And now, boys and girls, I would like to take this time to pray for all of you. So count on to pray. 4, 3, 2, 1. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your Bible, for showing us who you are and leading us along the path that you have called us for, God. I just pray for every boy and girl and any other individuals that are watching this today that they are able to fill their bowl of trust for you, God, that they find their trust to trust that you are who you say you are, to trust that Jesus is your son, God, to trust in your word, God. And I pray that you also give them understanding, God, as they are reading through your word, help them to understand what it is you're trying to say to them, God. This is my desire for all the people watching this, and I just thank you for everything that you are doing in this time, God, that you are finding the positives, and I just pray that you open our eyes to also see the world the way that you do, God. Let us see others through your light. And we just give you all the praise and all the glory, and we love you so, so much. In Jesus' name. And everybody said? And everybody said? Amen. Bye, guys.